was approximately 2 years ago when Max was graduating from the Union College Music Department, and I was sad to see him go after approximately 9 courses with me. So he's been a part, and he's been writing an opera, can you imagine? And we're going to hear some parts of it this evening. And afterwards there will be a reception and you're invited to come. So here's Anne-Marie of the Musicians of Marwick to talk about this evening's work.
Thank you. Being so impressed, in fact, sort of awestruck by the quality of his music, of his talent, of his maturity as a college senior in his writing style. And I was kind of amazed at what he was able to produce and sort of the scope of his music. In March of that same year, in 2016, we had put on a suffrage concert in collaboration with Siena College. And we had done it actually at Brothers, which was a really nice, unique location. In my research for that concert, I had looked at some blogs from the New York Historical Society, and there was this amazing description of two women, and I think, do you have it on screen? You do have it on screen. Two women in a glorified bicycle with wings, getting ready to take off on a cold December day, or I should say evening, in 1916. And you have to wonder what in the world was going through their heads. They're getting ready to fly over the New York Harbor. They have no, like, safety restraints. They're just sitting there. She's got her dress on and her high heels, and Lita has a little bit more appropriately dressed, but really, the bravery, the daring, the commitment to the suffrage cause is truly incredible with these women. So they take off on this cold December evening, and remember, it's around 5 o'clock in the evening. Wilson is in the harbor, President Wilson, to illuminate the Statue of Liberty with his first electric lights. And the irony of the famous figure of freedom is a female figure. And there's Wilson, who won't agree to support women, with other suffragists, by the way, and then these two women, with the approval of the National American Women Suffrage Association, endorsing this sort of plot. So they take off, gale force winds, they crash, but they're okay, and their story makes the national newspapers. So even though they don't physically follow through or are able to follow through with their plan, it's still this amazing story. And so I had read this blog and I was really fascinated with these women and the whole idea of telling this story through music. And I couldn't stop thinking about it. And I played Max's recital and I thought, maybe this is the right composer for this story. So I spoke to Max, and not only did he agree to write the opera, but he kind of ran with the project. He wrote the storyline, which is actually how you put it together. You have to have your plot. And then he crafted the libretto. He did a ton of research. In fact, if you go to Wikipedia and you type in Aleda Richburg Hornsby, you'll see that the entry was created by Max. He's just done really a fantastic job of compiling tons of information and turning it into what I think is a superb musical production. And so, in putting this all together, we also needed to find an appropriate location for it. We wanted to have something that wasn't a traditional or standard theatrical setting. So we're doing it at Clink, which is a bottle redemption site in the Glenville Business and Technology Park, which is, of course, the old Navy Depot. The site looks very much like an old airplane hangar, and in fact, in the 1940s, it was a tank repair repair facility for World War II. And so it's just the perfect place to do it. Our collaborators at Planck have just been incredible. They have not only allowed us to use the space, but they're so fully, I think, emotionally engaged in this project. It's just been a delight to work with them. And I think that when you walk into the space and you see what they've done to make it ready for us, and you come in not knowing quite what to expect, it adds to the theatrical element and the whole experience of the evening. So before we actually present really the first big public scenes, tonight's the first time people are really going to hear some of this, I would like to introduce some of the technical team to you and have you get a chance to hear some of the other aspects of the production. And then Max is going to come out and speak about the audio too. So I'd like to introduce Krista Dennis, who is our stage director for this production. Hello out there. I'm very, very excited to be working on this project with musicians of Malwick and Max Kaplan. I was particularly interested when Anne-Marie brought me on board because I've been working on the suffrage movement. I'm a stage director by trade, teach at Siena College, and I've written two plays about the suffrage movement, Votes for Women and Birth of a Ballot, which is actually about anti-suffragists. Albany was a profoundly anti-suffrage city. Schenectady was pro-suffrage. So I sort of wondered what the deal was with that and how women could be against their own enfranchisement.
Yeah.
So I started digging, and it became very, very, very interesting, as most of it seemed to be largely class-based. And there was a degree of fear of immigrants and all of these things. So I wrote a short play about the denizens of historic Cherry Hill in Albany, the Rankin family, who are a very, very interesting group of people and who were members of the Anti-Suffrage Society. So that one-act play is the opening for our opera, so we'll hear a little bit of that perspective, a bit of a garden party going wrong with the pros and the antis all in one place. So this story was particularly compelling because this issue was all around, right? Lita Richford Hornsby was not out there going, I'm a suffragist. She was out there going, I'm a pilot, right? These extremely enterprising women understood what a marvelous PR stunt it would be to convince her to work with them. And she was on their side. She was like, yep, that's I believe in the enfranchisement of women. So they convinced her to do this very deed. Or so the documents say, right? There's always that issue when you're working with historical material that I run into all the time with my work writing about historic figures. You don't know if what you're reading is true. And there's no way you will ever find out whether what you're reading is true. So you just have to really think about those perspectives. So I saw Max working in a way that was very similar to the way I played. Oh, this is fabulous. This is going to be a really great project to work on. It's being done the way I would do it. What could be better for a director than to work with a composer who works in that manner? A lot of my work deals with site specificity. I'm really interested in getting off the stage, getting away, getting out from under that proscenium arch, and getting into non-traditional theatrical spaces. It does not get much more non-traditional than a bottle redemption facility. And I could not be more delighted. It is a fabulous space. The acoustics are good. Phew! And it's very good, actually. We have some surprises in store in that space. It's really dynamic and very, very interesting. I think it probably has a few surprises in store for us when we go into the tech process. That's I will go ahead and introduce who's next from our team. Max. Max.
Thank you. off of women's nature, where nature herself had people down.
Push on in spite of the odds.
Not in spite.